Gethsemane Seventh-day Adventist Church, located at 2525 Sandiford Road, Raleigh, North Carolina. Our live stream service is for everyone and will begin shortly. Good morning. Today we start the Summer Sermon Playlist Series, beginning with Superstition Ain't the Way. Join us at 11:30 via Zoom, YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Here are Gethsemane's weekly announcements. Adventist Youth Ministries is today at 5 p.m. That's in person only. Gethsemane Cougar Pathfinders. There's a meeting today, June 4th, from 2 to 4 p.m. And if you're interested in joining the drum and drill teams, please join us tomorrow, Sunday, June 5th, 8 p.m. Meeting ID 806-932-911, passcode 0, capital LSTW, lowercase v, or check out your base camp schedule. Other meetings are Gethsemane School Finance Committee meeting June 5th at 9 a.m., followed by school board meeting at 10 a.m. And then on Sunday, June 12th, Gethsemane Church Finance Committee meeting, 9 a.m., followed by church board meeting at 10 a.m. Calling all graduates from the class of 2022, Gethsemane Seventh-day Adventist Church wants to recognize you on June 25th at 11:30 a.m. for our Divine Worship Service. Register now through June 22nd at GethsemaneSDAChurch.org. And please, don't forget to send that graduation picture to Veronica Parker at vgparker1@aol.com. There's a group of lady and men that are walking on June 5th and June 19th at the Hilltop Needmore Town Park and Preserve. That's 7 a.m. at 4621 Shady Greens Drive in Fuquay Verena. And they will be changing the park of where they walk each month. So if you'd like to participate, please see Elder Claudette McKenzie, Elder Linda Bowie, or Dr. Tawana Lordius for more information. Join us weekly Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. for Faith University. Our monthly topic for June is The Truth About Trouble. G-Hub Live is on a short hiatus for the month of May, returning June of 2022. With the fun fellowship and fire, so be prepared to tune back in. Virtual camp meeting will begin June 26th through July 2nd of 2022. Hope Beyond the Headlines. Morning services starts at 8 a.m. and evening services starts at 7 p.m. For more information, please go to sacsda.org. Men's Ministry presents a special meeting at the virtual camp meeting, 6 p.m. on Monday, June 27th, Wednesday, June 29th, and Friday, July 1st. Building Men for Eternity. Correction and making your four ways to give. Your mailing zip code is not 27620. It is 27620. 610. Gethsemane hosts a number of virtual events designed for you and your family each week. You're not going to want to miss out. So visit us at GethsemaneSDAChurch.org, Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, and of course, Sabbath mornings in person at Gethsemane Sanctuary. Don't miss out.
Go to the Gethsemane YouTube page and click on subscribe. Go to YouTube and type in Gethsemane SDA Church, all one word, and subscribe on our YouTube page and share this YouTube page with others. And secondly, find us on Facebook at Gethsemane SDA Church. Connect and share with us.
Gethsemane is in the process of keeping its members and visitors healthy. So if you're interested in worshiping with us, please know you will have your temperature checked, you must wear a mask, and screening questions are a requirement for in-person attendance. All of this can be done at our hospitality table each week before you enter the sanctuary. Again, Gethsemane is in the process of keeping its family safe and healthy. Our ushers are here to help serve you, so remember to only use the foyer doors to enter and exit the sanctuary, and please wait for our ushers to seat you and usher you out of the sanctuary. We hope you have a blessed worship experience here at Gethsemane Seventh-day Adventist Church. Welcome to Gethsemane Seventh-day Adventist Church, located at 2525 Sandiford Road, Raleigh, North Carolina. Our live stream service is for everyone and will begin shortly. Good morning. Today we start the Summer Sermon Playlist Series, beginning with Superstition Ain't the Way. Join us at 11:30. Via Zoom, YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Here are Gethsemane's weekly announcements. Adventist Youth Ministries is today at 5 p.m. That's in person only. Gethsemane Cougar Pathfinders. There's a meeting today, June 4th, from 2 to 4 p.m. And if you're interested in joining the drum and drill teams, please join us tomorrow, Sunday, June 5th, 8 p.m. Meeting ID 806-932-911, passcode 0, capital LSTW, lowercase V, or check out your base camp schedule. Other meetings are Gethsemane School Finance Committee meeting June 5th at 9 a.m., followed by school board meeting at 10 a.m., and then on Sunday, June 12th, Gethsemane Church Finance Committee meeting 9 a.m., followed by church board meeting at 10 a.m. Calling all graduates from the class of 2022. Gethsemane Seventh-day Adventist Church wants to recognize you on June 25th at 11:30 a.m. for our divine worship service. Register now through June 22nd at GethsemaneSDAChurch.org, and please don't forget to send that graduation picture to Veronica Parker at vgparker1@aol.com.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. It's been a long time that I stood before you, so you can give me a better welcome than that. I'm going to start again. Good morning and happy Sabbath.
Good morning.
Now that's a Gethsemane welcome. Thank you. And I would like to take the time to thank all our visitors that came with us, that came and chose to worship with us this morning. So thank you to all the many visitors in the sanctuary today. Thank you for watching us on Zoom, YouTube, Instagram, and Facebook Live. We are happy to have you in the house of the Lord today. And with that, let me give you a thought for today, because you know I love my thoughts. Y'all see my thoughts on the emails? Tell me if I ain't saying something. Happy moments, praise God. Difficult moments, seek God. Quiet moments, worship God. Painful moments, and I've had some painful moments, but I trusted God. And every moment that you are on this earth having something to say, thank God. Amen. Now, let's get on with some praise and worship.
Amen. We'll get on our feet. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Let's get on our feet and praise the Lord. Stand. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Oh, what a foretaste.
Oh, what a
glory divine.
Of glory divine.
Heir of salvation.
Heir of salvation.
Prince of God.
Purchased of God.
Born of the Spirit, washed in His blood. Everyone singing, this is my story.
This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Perfect submission.
Perfect submission.
Vision of rapture.
Now
burst
from my sight.
Angels descending.
Angels descending. Break from above. Angels of mercy. Whispers of love. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior. All the day long, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
Let's sing this with everything we have, perfect submission.
Perfect submission, all is at rest, I am my Savior. My story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all
sing
the
that
day
again.
Long. This is my story, this is my song.
Let's make this our testimony this morning. have faith in here. Amen. Join us in singing, we come.
We come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in His holy word.
Stay on the battlefield. I'm gonna stay.
still trust in the Lord until I die. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord until I
Amen. Are you trusting in the Lord this morning? This is the day that the Lord has made. We are indeed rejoicing and we are glad, aren't we, this morning? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, everybody. On behalf of Pastor Humphreys, who is on his way, want to extend welcome to our visitors on this morning. Want to acknowledge Pastor Norman, who is with us on this morning. Pastor Norman, thank you, you and your family, your wife, for being here with us on this morning, your lovely grandchildren, and your son-in-law for being here. We are so happy to have you guys worshiping with us on this morning. As well, we have some first-time visitors with us at Gethsemane. We have Joy. We have Evan, we have Oliver, and we have Bedell. Amen. Can you raise your hand? Amen, amen. We are happy to have you guys worshiping with us as well. And also, we have John. John, where are you? John Bishop, he is worshiping with us on this morning. Amen. John is from, well, Raleigh by way of Durham. Amen, amen. We are happy to have you, and we're happy to have all our visitors who are here this morning. We're happy that you've chosen to worship with us here at Gethsemane on this morning. And just want to share a couple of announcements on behalf of Pastor Humphreys. Want to share Gethsemane. Praise God. We have been praying and we have been asking the Lord after we had gone through our Money Talk series that we would meet our budget. Praise the Lord, we met our budget. Amen, amen. The treasurer texted me on this morning saying that we met our budget, and I want to think, is this the third time we met our budget in a row? Praise the Lord. Amen, amen. God is indeed hearing and answering prayer, and we want to say thank you to the faithful who return their tithe and their offering unto the Lord. Thank you to all who give. As well, want to praise the Lord and thank God for our steel package for our building. Our steel package for the building, it arrived on last week. Praise God for the steel package for the building arriving on last week. We are so thankful to God again for hearing and for answering prayer. This has been a long time coming, and thank God and praise God for the delivery. And there should be some work continuing on site on this week as we finish up the site work, putting in the retaining walls. And so thanking God for what he's doing on Gethsemane's behalf. And also, I want to acknowledge Sister Ashonda and her boys who are with us on this morning, Ashonda Singleton, Malcolm and Michael. They're with us on this morning. We're so happy to have you guys visiting with us as well. And I don't want to say visiting because you guys are members here. Amen. Praise the Lord. And at this time, we're going to continue with our service as outlined. We're going to have our praise dance team to come up. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're so happy to have our young children, our young girls coming before us on this morning. Praise the Lord.
Your hands have made the awesomeness of you.
That unfavorable diagnosis.
This is how you fight.
Somebody's saying it seems like trouble is all around me. Lachey, tell them it may look like.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
That's how God works.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Thank you, God.
That I'm surrounded by his grace.
Yes,
that I'm surrounded by his praise.
custom industrial machines in days.
Amen, amen. Let's say amen for our praise dance team.
Design your machine in the simplest online
CAD. You see those moves? That's some Ollie moves. God is available to us, amen? But I know you came here because you have a lot going on. There's a lot going on around our world today. And then we know that through prayer, all things are possible. And as the songs that were a song by our praise team says, this is my story. This is my song. And we're going to praise the Lord. So all of us here today have a story that we want the Lord to hear about. All of us have something going on that we want to intercede and we want God to hear. But he is the God who owns the cattle upon a thousand hills, so he knows everything about us. So if you have something you want to pray or you want to ask for prayer about, where you are, if you can kneel or you can stand, whatever is comfortable for you, and let us go into the Lord, to the Lord in prayer. Watching on Zoom or any social media platform, Facebook or YouTube, wherever you are, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for blessing us to allowing us, Lord, to come to your house this morning. Whether we are virtual, Lord, you are present. We thank you, Father, for forgiving us of our sins and all the things that we may have done and said, Lord, that are not pleasing to you or in your sight. Lord, we thank you for the breath of life. We thank you, Father, for the Sabbath day in which we get to set aside our daily mundane activities, Father, for us to come to you to pray and to praise your name. So much is going on around our world right now, Father. So much is happening in our communities right now, Lord. But we know, Father, you are still the God of Gilead. You are still the God of David and of Moses, Lord. You are still present today. And we know, Father, you are evermore available to us. Father, we thank you, Father, for this church and its leadership. We thank you, Father, for different auxiliaries in the school. We thank you, Father, for those that are working behind the scenes, Father, that's just doing so many things for your community, Father, for your people to continue to be elevated, for them to continue to feel spiritually renewed. We ask for blessings upon them. Father, we pray for those that are here today, for they come before you, Lord, with needs and burdens, sickness and disease, oh Lord. We pray, Lord, that you be with them for Sister Tanya, Lord. We had surgery, Lord. We pray for the Hortons family, Lord. We pray, Father, for those that are in the hospital right now, Father, undergoing surgery. We pray, Father, for the families in Texas and different parts of the country and New York, Lord, who are grieving the loss of loved ones, Lord. But, Father, we pray for the leadership of our countries and the local communities, the police departments. For they are, Father, have to make decisions on the fly, Father, whether to go in or to retreat. But Father, we know you are a God who does not need protocol. You don't need, Father, for us to wait. You just tell us to just come to you boldly before your throne. So here we are, Lord. So we're praying for those that are here today. Those that are on different virtual platforms, they have needs and desires. Touch them in a mighty way, oh Lord. We ask, Father, you be with the pastor as he, Father, comes before you, Lord, to deliver your message to your people. We pray, Father, that you will give him the anointing that he needs, Father, for the words to flow through him. And in the end, Father, all the praise and all the glory will go to you. We thank you in the matchless name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Unto the going down of the same, He is worthy, Jesus is worthy, He's worthy to be praised. Praise Him.
Get to fully participate in our own way. The Lord has blessed us with gifts and talents and resources, and we all get to share a portion of that blessing to Him. So here at Gethsemane, we have several ways that you can actually give without being here in the church. So you can give online, and those options are available to you on the screen, where you can return a faithful tithe unto the Lord. All the activities of the church, all the different auxiliaries are able to continue to function because of the gifts. So we praise God for your faithfulness, the fact that the local church can meet his budget. So we thank God that he'll continue to bless you, you know, abundantly, because the Bible tells us that God will open up windows of heaven, not a window, but windows of heaven, and pour out such a blessing there will not be room enough to receive it. So let us continue to be faithful until the end. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for the tithe and offering, Father, that your people have gone out in labor and brought forth, Father, to show you how much that they appreciate you, to show you how much they trust in your providence, to show you, Lord, that they trust that in times of need and times of scarcity, they will continue to trust you. So we ask, Lord, that you continue to bless them, Father, in whatever means necessary, physically, mentally, emotionally. Whatever they need, Father, they shall never lack thereof. For we know that you are still available and present to gift us in abundantly. So we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. And we ask that you continue to bless your people. And in the end, all the praise and all the glory go up to Calvary. Amen. And at this time, as you exit the sanctuary, our deacon is going to be available to you for you to place your tithe and offering on the basket. Be blessed. Happy Sabbath.
Good morning, boys and girls. Happy Sabbath to you. Boys and girls, mommies, dads, aunties, uncles, church family, welcome to another edition of our children's story. Well, today, boys and girls, I'm outside in a field, and guess what I have today? A boomerang. Have you guys seen a boomerang? If you throw it just right, you throw it, and guess what happens? It is supposed to go all the way around and come back around. Well, that story reminds me of how you and I should treat boys and girls, moms and dads, teachers, friends, everyone. If we are going to be Christians and we say that we are followers of Christ, we're going to what? We're going to show love. We're going to show patience, compassion to people. And so hopefully when we throw that love, throw that compassion, caring from others around, it'll come back to us. Just like in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 31 and 32, it tells us to stop being bitter and angry and mad at others. Don't yell at one another or curse each other or even be rude. Instead, Be kind and merciful and forgive others just as God forgave you because of Christ. Boys and girls, I want you to be like the boomerang and give love. Pass love, give out compassion to everyone, show mercy, and know that when you do that, it will come back to you, just like this boomerang. Let us pray, boys and girls. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today. We pray that you'll just bless us, that we can always show love, show mercy, show compassion to others, knowing that as we do that, it will come back to us. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Bye, boys and girls. Bye-bye.
This week, it has been a blessed week. I celebrated my birthday. Amen. And I am so happy that the Lord has blessed me. He has seen me through so many wonderful years. However, this morning, I want to say happy birthday to two special people. And not I want to say happy birthday, but Gethsemane would like to say happy birthday to two special people who will celebrate their birthdays, one on Monday and one on Wednesday. So we're going to ask Sister Jaleesa Humphreys and Arden Humphreys to join us. And Gifton is celebrating his birthday on today. Amen. So not only do we have a song that we want to sing, but we have something that we would like to present to you guys for your birthday. And I want to share this card. The card reads, "Birthday blessings. There is no one else like you." Sister Humphreys, there's no one else like you. God, He designed every detail of who you are, and He gave you gifts that only you can give to us and only you can give to the world. And those gifts that He has given to you, they will make a difference in ways that are wonderfully unique to just you. You are special, you are loved, and we are praying God's blessings to you on your birthday. And we ask that He gives you the best kind of blessings. Sister Humphreys, we love you, and we are honored to have you as our First Lady. Gethsemane Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Baby, so Jaleesa's gonna have to help me.
Oh, I can't get it out.
Oh, wow.
So this is for Sister Humphreys on behalf of Gethsemane. Sister Humphreys, happy birthday.
Thank you. Thank you.
not only is Sister Humphreys celebrating a birthday, Arden, you will turn one. Hey, Arden, are you ready for your birthday? And we are so happy that we get to celebrate the first baby. And we are indeed honored to have you as our first baby here at Gethsemane. And so we have a gift for you as well. Happy birthday, Arden. Happy birthday. Sister Humphreys and Arden, we love you guys. Enjoy your birthday and be blessed.
About the Lord and all that he does for you, I just get so excited and I'm so humbled that he thinks so much of us, and we're so unworthy and unfaithful sometimes, but when I think about the Lord and all he's done for me, I just say thank you, Jesus. It makes me want to shout hallelujah. And it is an honor to minister with these ladies when I think about the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
When I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he fills me with the Holy Ghost, how he heals me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picks me up and turns me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground.
When I think about the Lord,
when I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he fills me with the Holy Ghost, how he heals me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picks me up and turns me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, it makes me wanna shout hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna shout hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
When I think about the Lord,
when I think about the Lord,
how he saved me,
how he raised me, how he fills me with the Holy Ghost, how he heals me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord,
how he picks me up,
how he picks me up and turns me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground.
It
we want to shout, woo! Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout, woo! Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
It makes me
want to shout,
hey.
Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy,
of
all the glory, and all the honor, and all the praise. Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna Jesus, Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me wanna shout.
Anybody here grateful today? Anybody, any grateful people in the house of God today? God do anything that make you want to shout? Anybody just want to shout and say thank you, Jesus? Anybody want to shout for food on your table? Is there anybody want to shout for clothes on your back? Is there anybody want to shout that you woke up this morning and he started you on your way? Anyone want to shout that your children are safe? Is there anybody in here that wants to just take 10 more seconds and just give God your best praise? God, we thank you. God, we adore you. We magnify you. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everybody's standing. Everybody's standing to their feet for the reading of the Word of God. Let's put our hands together for blessed. Come on, say amen, somebody. Thank you, Lord. There's a word from the Lord today. I hope that it will encourage your soul. Forgive me for missing worship earlier this morning. I was over at East Wake, and we got caught up in worship, so had to come on here, and I got caught up again. So I'm grateful and thankful to be with you all today. We've had an awesome time in the Lord, and
I want to say thanks again to the church for honoring my wife and my daughter, who, you know, is just, they are my rock, and I just appreciate them. And I'm so glad that our daughter is going to be 1 year old. So we just praise God for that. My wife's getting the birthday, so we praise the Lord. And we are so honored to pastor this church. I would not be anywhere else, and I'm just so truly grateful today. But there's a word from the Lord today. And I want to summon your senses and invite your intellect to the book of John, the fifth chapter, starting at verse 1 to 11. You can see it on the screen there, or you can get a chance to look it up on your iPad or your phone or just good old-fashioned Bible. I hear some pages turning. That's John chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. That's how the New King James Version. And when you have it, say amen. If you need more time, say wait on me. I hear you. I hear you. John, the fifth chapter, verses 1 through 11. And here's what God has said to encourage your heart. It says, after there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there in Jerusalem by the sheep gate, a pool which was called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porches. And these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For it was said that an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whosoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well, who of whatever diseases they might have had. Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lying there, he knew he had already been in that condition for a long time. And he said to him, do you want to be made well? Sick man answered and said, sir, I have no one to put me in the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps in. Jesus said to him, rise, take up your bed and walk. Bible says immediately. Someone say immediately. The man was made well, took up his bed and walked. And it was the Sabbath day. The Jews therefore said to the man who was cured, y'all missed your shout. That's okay. We'll come back to that. Look at what the church folks say. It is the Sabbath. It is not lawful to carry your bed. And verse 11 is where I want us to tarry today. And he said to them, he who made me well said to me, take up my bed and walk. I want to preach, if I can, with the thought in mind, superstitions ain't the way. Superstitions ain't the way. Father, we thank you for the total sufficiency of Jesus Christ. We shout thank you and hallelujah for just all you've done for us. I've studied, but I still need your spirit. I've prepared, but I still need your power. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're going to be seated in the presence of the Lord today. Superstitions ain't the way. Today, we kick off a brand new series, our summer series entitled 2022 Summer Playlist. And can we just be honest today, church? Can we be honest in here? Music has shaped the history, especially those of us of color, for generations now. Anybody here love good music? Anybody, any folk who love, we just heard some good music. But can we have an honest conversation in church today? I'm going to be honest today that I'll testify that I know that you got Kirk Franklin in your car, and you got Donnie McClurkin and Fred Hammond, but truth be told, through the week, you are not listening to Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross. Can we be honest today that some of y'all, if I could go into your car and, Tim, turn on your iPod and see what you were really listening to during the week, some of y'all got some Luther Vandross on your playlist. Some of y'all got some Temptations on your playlist. Can we be honest today that, truth be told, I know that you like Yolanda Adams, but you got Homecoming Beyonce album on your playlist right now. Do I have a witness in this place that'll testify that we love good music? And the reality is music has shaped us, but there's some key messages and key tools in music that I believe can take us into a greater experience with God. And so today our sermon is really based on one of the greatest musical minds of all times, because back there in the 70s, in fact, 1972, Stevie Wonder at 22 years old penned one of the greatest songs of all time, Superstition. I mean, when that bass begins to play and that music gets going, people start to jam. But Superstition was most known not just for its musical talents, but also, Reggie, for the message that it had. When Stevie Wonder was interviewed after selling 3 million copies of this song, they asked him all about Superstition. He said, I wrote this song because the truth of the matter is I don't believe in superstitions. He went on to say that I don't believe that breaking glasses or the number 13 will give you bad luck. I don't believe in walking under ladders will ruin your day. He said, when you believe in things that you don't understand, then you'll suffer. Superstition ain't the way. See, Stevie Wonder sings of how many of us can be blinded in those days could succumb to different superstitions. But I believe this, as believers, there is no place for superstition in or around the church, because we walk by faith and not by sight. We don't need superstitions, because the reality is I don't need a rabbit's foot or a lucky charm, because the name of the Lord is still a strong tower. Do I have a witness in this place? And the reality is, everybody, that we see so many people who buy into these superstitions that live a life that Stevie Wonder says that you are living your life at a lesser value if you believe in superstitions, that we can jam and celebrate that song. But if we miss the undertone note there, Stevie Wonder is telling us how to live our best life. And it's interesting, at this text in John chapter 5 at the pool of Bethesda, it is one of the greatest superstitious stories of all time. Y'all have heard about the pool of Bethesda. Y'all know the story. The Bible says at this pool of Bethesda, what is also known as the house of mercy, is not really the house of mercy when you get real close. That as you get closer, those who are sick, those who are lame, have come to this house because they believed in the superstition that an angel would come and it would touch the water. And the Bible says that whosoever got into it first, when they would come out, they would be healed. In fact, Spirit of Prophecy says that hundreds of people would come by this pool waiting for a move of the water. But how many people know that God does not operate like that? That God does not operate based on the first person to hop into anything. I thank the Lord that I don't have to wait on God. I can just call him whenever I need him. But these people were so caught up in this superstition that they actually believed you would get better, when in reality, Dr. Nehemiah, the whole point about this Bethesda pool is that actually the pool of Bethesda is just a hot spring. See, a hot spring is basically what happens is when it rains and the water goes through the different rocks and the cracks, it gains certain minerals like zinc or like calcium. And what happens is, if you've ever been to a hot spring, that when water begins to bubble up, it's the best time to get into that pool, because what'll happen is, Elder Smith, is that it'll make your skin look real good. So when you come off, you give the appearance that you're healed, but the nutrients only deals with the skin. It doesn't go skin deep. And do I have anybody in here who can testify that what I need from God is not just a surface healing? God, I need you to heal me from the inside out. See, the writer literally said that the people believed that the stirring of the water was so strong that people would come from miles to receive a power that would not deal with their dysfunction. Now, it's interesting, in this text, the text says that as Jesus gets there, there's a man there who has been sick for 38 years. Now, he's not been at the pool 38 years, but he's been dealing with his issue for 38 years. Yes, it's hard for him to deal with his dysfunction. Yes, people consider him less than. Yes, the church has literally been an oppressor. Obstacles have come by the culture, and he's been ostracized from the community. He can't get no help from the church because this pool is outside the church. Okay, I'm going to help you. What I'm trying to say is that a superstitious power is outside the front door of the church. See, the elders of the church know that this ain't no angel coming to touch the water, because they know God doesn't operate like that. But to keep these sick
folk off of the city streets. They allowed this pool to be there so that these folk won't be a distraction to folk who come into the town. And so all of these people who are coming to church are stepping over those who are sick just to get into the house of God. And I want to help somebody today, because the reality is that this brother is not just dealing with y'all the sickness that he has, but he's dealing with oppression from the church, obstacles from the culture, and he's ostracized from the community. The culture doesn't like him because they see him as unclean. The church won't invite him inside because he's got an ailment, because he must have sinned. And the community won't deal with him because he's different than everybody else. But can I help somebody out today, that just because I'm different doesn't mean I'm deficient? Can I help somebody out today? Like so often we see people who are different and we see them as deficient. And what God is saying is that just because you're blind, it doesn't mean you are deficient. Just because you've got an ailment does not mean that you are less than. It just means that you're different than other people. And what the text shouts at us, y'all, is that your condition will oftentimes attract obstacles. Now, I want to help somebody with this, y'all. The church leadership has set up in such a way that they have wrongfully diagnosed deficiency within the church and outside the church. I need y'all to hear that again. The church misdiagnosed people and said because they look different, we can't invite them into the building. You know what? Since Leviticus, they have been taught that if you are blind or lame from birth, then you cannot enter the house of God. And since Leviticus, even to now in the 21st century, the church is misdiagnosing different people. Okay, so I'm going to help you today. See, we love here at the church to say, man, if she'll just get to the altar and get around some church folk, then I know her situation can get better. No, that lady needs some therapy. Do I have a witness in this place? See, we'll say all the time, if that brother can just join a ministry and serve as a deacon, then maybe his things will get right. No, that brother needs community and people to pray for him. Well, this person won't sow the right seed, and this person won't give here. That's why they're always broke. No, that family needs help with the family budget. See, the reality is we have missed out on diagnosing people because they're different. And I want to help somebody in here today. Thank God that we all not the same. Oh, I can't get no help in here today. That's okay. See, the reality is you different and I different, and thank God. Could you imagine if we were all the same? We would drive each other crazy. Like, I know she don't lead like you or serve like you or sing like you or do ministry like you, but that don't mean they don't hold any value. Church is going to get real quiet here. That's okay. And see, the reality is, y'all, this could have been an opportunity for the Holy Spirit to move. I want you to hear what Ellen White says. I'm going to give you some Ellen White. She says this: hundreds were pressed back and could not get near the water. Many were disappointed who suffered, had hardship, pains, and efforts. They got close to the pool. Listen what Ellen White says. Many of the people died outside the church trying to get to a superstitious pool. Ellen White says that leaders would step over them and say, God bless you, as these people were trying to reach for something that would not work. But do I have a witness in this place that can testify that we don't serve a God that's first come, first serve? Oh, y'all didn't hear what I said. We don't serve a God that's first come, first serve. You don't got to wait in line to talk to God. You don't got to pull a ticket to call his name. All you've got to do is call on the name of the Lord. Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help do I know. You don't got to talk to some man in a box. You don't got to wait your turn in line. You can call God in the shower. You can call God at work. Do I have any real believers in here that'll testify? You don't have to wait to church to call on the name of the Lord. You can call God wherever you are. And see, here's the thing, everybody, is that Jesus is so good, y'all. He's coming into town and he don't have his disciples with him. Oh, God, help me to preach here. Jesus is on assignment by himself. Spirit of prophecy says that when he comes in and sees the pool, because of how Jesus is, Elder Lordius, his heart goes out to them. But spirit of prophecy says, because of how the church might react, he says, I can't heal everybody because they might try to kill him before it's time. But see, Jesus walks into the pool by himself. So let me help you with this. So, when I was in Washington, North Carolina, we were having a major event for our young people in the city, and we had these computer games lined up, and we were so grateful because somebody donated us eight what we thought was brand new computers, and we were sitting there thinking to ourselves, we can't wait to show these things off. As you turn the computers on, every computer had a virus that we couldn't get off, and now I know why they donated them. So, what I begin to do, we begin to call Best Buy and Geek Squad, but we needed an appointment. We would call other places, but we needed an appointment. We end up calling a place out here in Raleigh, but they says, no, you can't come in unless you have an appointment. So we finally begin just to drive around the city, and we saw a sign that says, we fix computers. We walked in with our computers, and we said, sir, we know we don't have an appointment, but can you please see us? And without the man answering, he pointed up at a sign that says, welcome all, we take walk-ins. Oh, y'all missed that. See, they're a small business, but they do good work, and they want you to know that we can give you all the benefit because we take walk-ins. And I came by to let someone know today that Jesus is in the business of taking walk-ins, that all you've got to do is call on the name of the Lord. All you've got to do is cast your care. Anybody here grateful that you don't have to make an appointment to see Jesus? So the text says, y'all, that not only does your condition attract obstacles, but your condition is attractive to Jesus. Okay. Jesus, the Bible says, y'all, this man has been there for 38 years. He has been there waiting for the move of the water. And the Bible literally says, y'all, that he's so wretched that Jesus can't help but pass. He's like, I can't pass this guy by. Now y'all missed that. He was so jacked up that divinity told him, don't leave. Now, you're not shouting because you don't think you're the man in the text. But do I have anybody in here that'll be honest today with the pastor that you are so jacked up and you are so messed up and you've got so many things going on in your life, you can't afford for Jesus to pass you by? I'm the pastor. I'll be the first to admit that, God, I got so much going on. Please don't pass me by. So the text says, y'all, when he sees the man, and I love this, I think he's not only is he attracted, y'all, to this man's condition, but he's also attracted to the man's anticipation. See, y'all, we know how the story goes. The Bible says that he says, look, man, the Lord says, do you want to be made whole? The brother lets us know. Y'all know the story. I try to get into the pool, but nobody puts me in. And then preachers proceed to beat the man up. Oh, man, you always making excuses. All you should do is say, God, I want to be made whole. But stop right there for a second. This man has been there 38 years. The church didn't do their job telling them that this was a lie. He doesn't know any different. And so what he tells Jesus is just simply the truth. I try to get into the pool, but nobody will help me in. But y'all, he's still there. Which means he has a spirit of anticipation that I don't know when it's going to happen, but I'm going to be here just in case it does. Do I have any believers in the house of God that still have anticipation? And see, the reality is the church of God can move forward when the people of God move on anticipation. That I don't know when it's going to come, but I'm going to be ready when God makes his move. Okay, so I told y'all I was in Raleigh to see my mom out of Raleigh as she graduates. And I mentioned before that I flew first class. I want to say again, I'm not bougie. I'm just blessed. It's just for your story purposes. But it's interesting. And y'all know, all right, I'm a little bougie. But y'all know how you in line get on your flight and you know you got your number. And I was number one because I was first class, right? So, you know, when they call your number, the people in first class should stand up and get to the front of the line. All you B class and C class and 3-4, you sit your behind down somewhere until your name is called, right? So it's interesting that I'm the first one in line, but there's a sister next to me, and she's got her 2 carry-on bags, and when they call us forward, we all move, and she stands there. And I thought to myself, that's interesting. She stood up with us. Maybe she didn't have the right ticket. Maybe she didn't know to stand with us because she's not first class. That's what I said to myself. But she was the first in line, but the last one on the plane. When I got to my connecting flight, she was also there, and it happened again. As they called first class, we stood right next to each other. In fact, she was standing there the whole time. She stood there, and I stood there. When they called us through, we went on through, and she stayed there. She was the last one on the plane, but this time, she was sitting right next to me on first class. Now, I looked at the lady and said to myself, I saw you stand up the first time. Were you not able to get in first class? And she says, well, no. She says, I'm a standby flyer. Oh, God, help me to preach in here. She said, as a standby flyer, I've just got to be ready just in case somebody misses their flight. Oh, you're going to get this in a minute. Which means, y'all, she didn't pay for first class, but she got all the benefits that first class had to offer. Do I have anybody in the house of God that's a standby saint who will testify that I'm waiting on God to move? I'm waiting on God to restore. I'm waiting on God to pay it. I'm waiting God to open the door. I'm a standby Christian because if I stand, I'm standing on the rock of ages. I'm standing on the word of God. Is there anybody standby Christians who can testify? I'm waiting until my blessing comes. I'm a standby Christian. So Jesus, he sees the brother, and he knows how different he is. He knows how messed up he is. But I need y'all to understand this, is that divine intervention is why Jesus is here today. Remember I told you, it's a feast going on. That's what the Bible says. He is not with his disciples. When he sees the man, he knows what the man is dealing with. And Tim, he says, do you want to be made well? Now, y'all heard this story 1,000 times, and preachers typically say, oh, why would Jesus ask some random question like that? The brother been there 38 years. Of course he wants to get healed, Jesus. Why would you ask some stupid question like that? But see, Jesus is not asking him a question. Jesus has made him an offer. Okay. Y'all missed the text. He says, do you want to be made well? Okay, y'all missed it over here. Jesus looked at the man and said, do you want to be made, oh God, well? See, the creator of the universe who made the stars in the sky, who made the oceans below, just looked at this brother and said, do you want to be made? And how many know that God can make some things? He formed man in his image. He made the birds in the sky and the animals on the... Do you want to be made well? Now, Penny, it's interesting that this text actually correlates with John 1, where it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was made flesh. Okay, y'all follow me so far? So when the brother says, I have no one to put me in, that's just a realistic answer to the thing that Jesus told him. The next thing that Jesus says is, why don't you come to, he don't say come to my church and fill out a form. He doesn't say how long have you been a Bible-believing Christian. He don't ask him if he's vegetarian or vegan. Jesus says, I want you to get up, take your mat, and walk. Now, the reason why that's so significant is because literally the person that said, let there be light, just spoke into his original creation. And the Bible says that immediately. See, before he couldn't make it to the pool, but now immediately he's able to get up. Now, y'all, I love this text so much, we tend to celebrate and go home on that. But I got to teach here. Look at the response of the church folk. It's going to get real quiet in here. The Jews and the religious leaders looked at him and saw the man. First of all, the text says they saw the man who was made whole. Right. They said, who told you to take up your mat? It's the Sabbath. God, help me not to get in trouble here. But y'all know, we got some superstitions in church. Yeah. See, there's some people who still think that 11 o'clock is the holy sanctified hour. That God can't move unless it's 11 a.m. There are some people in Christianity that actually believe that you don't baptize on the left side, you actually baptize on the right side, because the right side is the holy side, and that's a bunch of foolishness, because as long as I get up into the water, that's all that really matters. So look at the church police. Instead of saying, because they've stepped over the man 38 years now. They know who the brother is. But now nobody says, congratulations, let's do a dinner for you. Let's bring you on stage at church and say, he's healed now. Now he can come. The first thing they say is, who told you to carry your mats? And see, this is where I need you to understand, for those who are struggling here. Jesus does not need to move you out of your place of disappointment to heal you. He heals the man in his place of disappointment, the place where he could never touch the pool. And the offer that Jesus gave him was not to get into a pool that don't work. The offer was to receive water, but it ain't come from no pool. It came from the living water of life. And so what's interesting here is, y'all, this is what the man told him. The man literally tells them, the one who healed me told me, take up my mat and walk. You see, because the reality is, when people see what God has done for you, they cannot question what God has already told you to do. See, God has told you to move. I don't need to answer to you. Just check with him over there. See, because I once was blind, but now I see. I once was lame, but now I walk. I used to be dead, but now I'm alive. And the reality is, y'all, the Bible says that they cannot handle the brother's healing. But the text says immediately he took up the thing he'd been laying on for 38 years. And the thing that was holding him, he's now holding it. And that's a word for somebody in the house of God today, that the thing that has been holding on to you, God's getting ready to allow you to hold on to it. So you better get a hold of your marriage. Get a hold of your children. Get a hold of your finances. Are y'all hearing me today? Get a hold of situations that God can still do exceedingly, abundantly, above all. So it's interesting that Jesus knew that this man had been there 38 years because it was on his itinerary. The Father had already sent it to him, and that's why I believe that he was alone. This was a covert mission between him and his Father in heaven. Okay, I'm going to help you, and then I'm going to take my seat. So a couple of years ago, way before I had Arden, so I had all this free time on my hands then, but I was just, you know, watching something, Iris, you know, Sunday morning, and nothing's on TV, right? But this show, oh, help me, Holy Ghost, Sanford and Son was on TV. Okay, I ain't the only one. Anybody ever know, everybody seen Sanford and Son before? So Sanford and Son, you know, it's a good show. I ain't gonna lie, it's good. But it's funny. So Sanford and Son, it's a father-son business. You know, the father tells the son, go out there, get the trash, bring the trash back from the junkyard. They clean off stuff that people threw away, and they sell it on the market. You missed that. I'm going to tell you that again. Okay. I was watching Sanford and Son one Sunday morning, right? I had nothing to do. Y'all know what Sanford and Son is about? Sanford and Son goes like this. It's a father-son business. The father tells the son to go get the trash that people threw away. Come on. The son goes out to get the trash. The son brings the trash back to the father. The father cleans it up and puts it back on the market. Y'all missed that. I'll say that one more time. I was watching Sanford and Son one Sanday afternoon. Sanford and Son goes like this. It's a father-son business. The father tells the son to go get the trash that nobody else wants. The son goes to get it, picks it up, and cleans it off, and brings it back to the father. The father takes it and puts it on the market. Is there anybody in here that can testify that Jesus and God, that's a father-son business? He told the son to go get us when sin threw us away. He died for us and he rose for us. brought us back to the Father, and you're here today, blessed, alive, and well, because he picked you up, turned you around, placed your feet on solid ground. Is there anybody in here that's blessed? Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm better now. I'm stronger now. I'm healed now. I'm alive now. And it has nothing to do with me, but everything to do with the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Is there anybody in here that wants to just thank God that the Father and the Son found you in the trash, cleaned you up, and you're alive today? Say yeah, yeah, yeah. Come on, give God your best praise, because he found you when people threw you away. Nobody wanted to deal with you, but God found you. Nobody wanted to talk to you, but he talks to you, because he'll stick closer than a brother. Come on, Ron, nothing but the blood, nothing but the blood. I need you to hear me today. I need you to hear me today. Years, and one conversation changed his life. I need you to know that the text goes on to say in verse 15 that Jesus, because of what the uproar was going to be, had to slip away. I need you to watch what the text says. Verse 15 says, y'all, and this is going to set somebody free. Verse 13 says, but the one who has healed him, they did not know it was Jesus, but he had drawn away. The multitudes being in that place afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, see that you have been made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you. Verse 15 is what blesses me. Then the man departed from there and told the Jews it was Jesus that had made him whole. It's nobody but Jesus. There is no superstition. We don't believe in that here. I don't care what deficiency that you think you might have, you're welcome in this house. What can make me whole? What can make me? Nothing but the blood. Hallelujah. Singing, oh, hallelujah. Is. Thank you, God. Makes me. No other. Nothing but the blood. My appeal is simple today. There's somebody here that doesn't need a pool of Bethesda. You need this pool back here. And I'll be honest, ain't no minerals in this pool. Ain't no moving of an angel in that pool. That pool is symbolic to say that I want my life to be better. So my appeal is simple today. Does anybody need a start over, a jump start with Jesus, and says, you know what, Pastor? I need to be baptized, rebaptized. I need to get some things together in my life. I don't know who you are, what you're going through, but this word was for you today. And if that's you and says, Pastor, I need to be baptized and recommit my life, just raise your hand and we'll do it there. Come on, sing that song again while
Where are you? Where are you? Nothing but the blood. Where are you today? It says, God, I got to be restored. Where are you? Nothing. Let's all stand to our feet. Stand to our feet. Let's all stand to our feet. What can make me whole? Where are you? Oh. Don't miss your moment for greater. Where are you? Nothing but the blood. Father, today we don't need to claim a superstition because your blood still works. So God, today we are praying for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to fill the room even now. That God, on the sound of my voice, there is someone here, Lord, that needs a visit from Jesus. So God, I'm praying right now that you will do a walk in and see someone's home today. Do a walk in and head to someone's job for Monday morning. There's someone here that when they go home, they're afraid to be alone. In the name of Jesus, I'm praying for a spirit of liberty to fill that place. God, I'm praying for parents in the house of God that need a financial blessing for their children. God, open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing. God, don't stop by here and just pass us by. Have your way in our lives. And God, I'm praying for the person here today, God, who is still not certain they should make a decision to follow you all the way. Here is my declare and my decree. God, bother them. Give them sleepless nights until they make a call for you. God, I'm praying right now in the name of Jesus that you would restore the church, God. There's folk here who are broken, who need you, Lord. And so, God, we want this to be a place that even when the healing is not about me but my neighbor, we can celebrate for what you've done. So, God, we thank you in advance for all that you've done and that you will do. In Jesus' name we pray again. Amen. Come on, let's sing that. That nothing, nothing but the Jesus. Hallelujah. Let's put our hands together. If you love the Lord, put your hands together for Jesus Christ this. Before you go, we want to say thank you to our online viewers. Thank you so much for being here. For those that do not know, we have lifted the restrictions for our seating. So we'd ask that you be a part of our worship experience to come on back. We are still COVID-free, friendly here. Masks are still required, but we still believe in keeping safe. But we believe that the house is safe for those to come and experience worship. But if you're watching us online and you just want to continue to, we just appreciate your presence. I do want to mention to you that across the street, I know that you can't see it because of the cars, but the steel is actually on the lot. Come on, say amen, somebody. Come on, say amen, somebody. Yeah, I've had members taking selfies with the steel and pictures with it and sending it to me, you know, because we're so happy for what's taking place. Now, I just need to say this so everybody here today, we are still on track to meet our desired time of this year. And over the next several weeks, we're going to be presenting some different things. We put some committees together because as a building is being built, we want to make sure that we have the best building, not only externally, but internally. And that's going to require your knowledge and your input. And so we appreciate that. Also, want to let you know that this summer play this series, we're going to have a good time with this. No, I'm not going to play the song in church, I don't think. But we're excited for that. So listen, if you see that on Facebook and I'm asking different questions, don't be shy to tell the pastor you listen to stuff beyond just Christian music. All right, y'all, don't be afraid of that. But we'll have some Christian music to share, too. But I'm excited about this series, and I believe that God has got some powerful things for us. Before we go, we see Brother Wynn. Brother Wynn, wave your hand. Brother Wynn is back there in that nice cream suit. He's back there. as well with the deacons today, and they were willing to take up your offering. Please still continue to give faithfully in your tithe and offering. We thank God for what he has done today. Come on, say amen, somebody. I don't want to forget, I believe that Pastor Norman, are you here today? Pastor, praise God for you. Pastor, put your hands together one more time, Pastor Norman, who's here. We praise God for you. Also want to give a big shout out to my brother at Lear, who is here, him and his wife all the way from Atlanta. Let's put our hands together for my brother at Lear and his family, his daughter. Good to see you, brother. Let's all pray together. Father, we say thank you for your grace and your mercy towards us and your abundant care. Oh God, thank you for what took place today. Now bless us as we go and bring us back again on next week. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Please be seated momentarily. The ushers will usher us out. Happy Sabbath, everybody, and we look forward to seeing you.